What time is it? You know what time it is. It's time to hit that subscribe button. You know just where it's at. Right down there. Right down there. And it's time to find my Instagram. That's Geekly Amanda. G-E-E-K-O-Y Amanda. It's the same on Twitter. Make sure to follow me there too. And it's time to get this reaction video started. Me, you know I love my Krishna. Oh, I love my Krishna. I do. And I want to just watch everything, react to everything, gain all the Krishna knowledge over here. I do. Well, this right here is called Krishna, a complete incarnation of the divine. I was like, well, you know, I got to check this out about my Krishna. It's a little long. It's 15 minutes, but y'all ready to do this with me? Let's just get it started. Let me get in position. Ready? Go!
Krishna Avatara was considered as a complete avatara, or a complete incarnation of God. The consciousness that we refer to as Krishna, if we have to be touched by this, we need Leela. Leela does not mean just dancing with somebody. You're willing to dance with death.
What?
You're willing to dance with life.
That is deep.
Very, very few human beings ever get to be placed in as complex situations as Krishna was placed.
Well, he's a guy.
In one human being's life, going through the variety of situations that he went through is generally, it doesn't happen to most human beings. And in all these situations that he was faced with, the clarity of vision that he exhibited and the certainty about his ability to discern as to what is true and what is not true.
I noticed that just watching the Mahabharats.
The clarity that he brought to
the
people
clarity,
around him.
Yes.
People began to experiencing like God-like.
He just saw.
So he was proclaimed as an incarnation, and a complete incarnation.
Is there incomplete
incarnations? For those of you who are not familiar with this.
Oh, he's going to tell me.
They talk about 9 incarnations.
Okay. I've heard of that.
I want you to understand, this is what I'm going to say now, is much before Charles Darwin came. So the first incarnation was Matsyavatara. That means God appeared in the form of a fish.
His first incarnation was in the form of a fish?
And you know, Charles Darwin went about proving the first form of life on the planet were water life, fish.
Look at that.
And the next incarnation is Kurmavatara. That means it's a turtle. It's an amphibious animal, half water, half land. Charles Darwin said this also. The third incarnation is Varahavatara, which is in the form of a pig, a gross mammal. And the fourth incarnation is Narasimhavatara.
Oh, half
that
man.
Is half man and half animal.
Look at this.
The next one is Vamanavatara, a dwarf.
A dwarf?
Human form, but a dwarf. The next one is Parashurama.
That just shows how God is
a full-grown man.
In all things.
But an extremely violent man.
Really?
A great fighter. We will meet him shortly, here also. Krishna meets him, so he's still alive. So Parashurama is a fighting man.
This is so interesting.
He even lopped off the head of his own
what?
Mother. A very violent man.
Oh my gosh!
The next one is Ramavatara, a very peaceful one.
Oh, well look.
A very unidimensional kind of
Rama.
Man. The next is Krishnavatara, a very multidimensional human being.
Krishna. Hare Krishna.
So Krishna Avatara was considered as a complete avatara or a complete incarnation of God, not just one aspect.
I still don't understand what that means. Like some
are as a tribute to the multidimensional nature of who he was. And though he himself never claimed it, even if he had not claimed it, people around him naturally identified him as divine.
See, you didn't have to. You just gave off that. Even watching him.
In this identification that people attached to him.
Even watching him, actors play him, I just.
The whole culture.
You know?
Evolved around this identity of Krishna being a complete incarnation of the divine. When we say Krishna,
I like this guy.
The essence of who he is.
I like his storytelling.
He is an irrepressible child.
He always
is. A terrible prankster.
Not terrible, I love his pranks. Little Krishna pranks.
An enchanting flute player. A graceful dancer.
Oh, I've never seen Krishna's dance skills.
An irresistible lover.
Why?
A truly valiant warrior. A ruthless vanquisher of his foes.
I haven't seen that before.
A man who left a broken heart in every home.
Why a broken heart? Is he laughing?
An
astute to break heart?
Statesman and kingmaker. A thorough gentleman. A yogi of the highest order. And the most colorful incarnation. Krishna is seen and perceived and understood and experienced in many, many different ways by different people. Duryodhana, through the eyes of Duryodhana. For those of you who do not know the background, because unless you understand the whole tapestry of the story and the situation in which he existed, many aspects of who he is will be missed, so we will go into it. But right now, Duryodhana is a man because of certain situations into which he was placed. Insecure, angry, jealous.
He ain't the mean prince, is he? Is that who he's talking about?
Greedy and feeling wronged all his life. And because of actions which came forth from his greed and anger.
You're talking about the mean prince.
He became the key for destruction of his whole race. In Duryodhana's words, he is a smiling rogue, if there was ever one. He can eat, he can drink, he can sing, he can dance. He can make love, he can fight.
He's got all the compliments for himself.
He can gossip with old women, play with little children. Who says he is God? That's Duryodhana's perception.
He thinks it's fun.
Shakuni. The very embodiment of deception and cunning.
With his eye and his bad teeth in the Mahabharata.
Shakuni says, let us suppose he is God.
What?
So what? What can a God do?
Shakuni, I don't like you.
God can only please those devotees who please him. Let him be God.
He said, let him. That's what he said.
I don't like him.
I don't like him either. I'm with you.
And when you don't like somebody, you must praise them.
That's what his own words. I thought he was saying he didn't like him.
Radhe.
Oh.
his childhood lover.
Don't make me because they always get me tears
up. A simple woman of the village.
I didn't know that was his childhood lover.
With such unfaltering love and devotion, she has become so big that today you cannot talk of Krishna without Radhe. We don't say Krishna Radhe, we say Radhe Krishna. She has become a simple village woman. She has become as significant as Krishna, or little more significant than him. She said, Krishna is with me.
Isn't Krishna with all of us?
He is always with me. Wherever he is, whoever he is with, he is still with me.
Aww.
That's her perception.
But he's inside all of us. I feel that way too.
Vantaya.
I don't know
who that is. A youth who was the Garuda chief's eldest son, living on the mountains of Gomantak.
I don't think I heard this story.
A sprightly youth, because of a certain ailment, became totally crippled.
Ooh.
This crippled youth, after he met Krishna, Krishna made him walk. So Vayantaya said, he is God. He is God. He is God.
Miracles. Look at that. He likes to laugh. He likes to laugh at with their dialogue.
Akrura, an uncle of Krishna, a wise and saintly being,
he takes a lot of pause.
Expressed his perception of Krishna this way. Krishna, when I look at him, this strange young boy, I see the sun, the moon, and the seven stars whirling around him. When he speaks, he sounds like the voice of the Eternal.
Wouldn't it be amazing to be there?
He's the hope.
Oh, the hope. Oh, don't make me cry.
If there is hope in this world, he's the hope. Shikandin, a tortured human being, because of a certain situation within himself, right from his child. This is an absolutely tortured soul. So Shikandin said, Krishna never gave me any hope. But when he is there, the breeze of hope touches everybody.
Why is this making me cheer up?
I can go on like this.
Do! I want to hear it all! I want to hear it all!
Some different facets of who he is. For some he's God, for some he's a crook, for some he's a lover, for some he's a fighter, so many things he is. If we want to taste an essence of what it means when we say Krishna, the consciousness that we refer to as Krishna, if we have to be touched by this, we need Leela.
I'm still trying to find what this Here Leela is about. There we go.
For the Leela.
That's what I want to
Leela
know.
Leela means it is the path of the playful.
Oh, I'm always playful.
This is not for the serious times.
Oh, that's me. That's me. That's why he's always laughing.
Because when I say playfulness, we are not here just to play. We are here to explore the most profound and the most serious aspect of life, but playfully, conducted playfully. Otherwise, Krishna won't be there. The reason why the most profound dimensions of life have been missed by the vast population in the world is because they do not know how to be playful.
I feel this.
If you want to explore this path playfully, if you want to be playful, you need a heart full of love, a joyful mind, and a vibrant body.
What's a vibrant body?
Otherwise, there's no leader.
What's a vibrant body?
If one has to explore the most profound dimensions of life in a playful way, they must be willing to play with their awareness, with their imagination, with their memory, with their life, with their death. They're willing to play with everything. Only then, Leela. Leela does not mean just dancing with somebody. You're willing to dance with death. You're willing to dance with life. You're willing to dance with your enemy. You're willing to dance with the one whom you love. You're willing to dance the last moment of your death. Only then there is Leela.
Let me get myself together here. Why is it? It's just funny because this morning I saw a comment. Someone's like, why are you always crying and overreacting? I'm like, I guess you could call it overreacting, because I even am shocked by sometimes when I feel like I feel the tears flowing. I am. Like watching this. I'm like, stop it, Amanda. Stop it. I start tearing up and I'm like, stop it. This isn't sad. This isn't like, but when I am sometimes, I feel like when tears come, when you're just so full of emotion that there's no other way to release it. And when we talk about, or I watch something or learn something and hear the stories of Krishna, and it just gives me this sense of so many feelings, like calmness and peacefulness when I hear about Krishna. Like, he just brings peacefulness and joy. But at the same time, like, empowerment, I guess, is the word. Because, you know, feeling that he's always with us, like they said, you just know you always have him there. And since I first learned about it, that people call, they're like, you're now crazy Amanda, Miss Krishna. And I'm just like, because the moment I learned about Krishna and started learning this and going through this journey, it's just opened my eyes to so many things that I feel like I already knew, but now I can give it direction. And maybe that awareness also makes me just tear up. It just brings out so many emotions. And then I think just watching, you know, the Mahabharata, which is the scriptures of the day, and actually seeing on screen the things Krishna did, and even the actor who plays him, when he just says Krishna's words, I just fit. Like, I'm watching the show, right? I'm watching the show and I'm like, oh yeah, it's about, I mean, not everything's accurate, I know that, but a lot of it is. It comes from the scriptures, and I'm watching, and I'm like, yeah, oh, you know, following along. But then when Krishna comes on screen and it's just the actor who plays him, but, and he starts just delivering the words of Krishna and the wisdom, and I tear up a lot watching that too. I was watching it last night. I was on season 10 and just watching the Draupadi, when the whole thing with the perfect shot to win her hand, or to try to marry her. I forgot what's the word called, the suave, or when she's trying to find her husband, and then Krishna stands up and just delivers these words of wisdom. I'm crying. And it's not because maybe I am overreacting. Maybe it's this, I'm just over emotional sometimes. But it's just because I just have, you know, all these feelings in me, so many mixed feelings that I feel like that he brings about when I'm just think of them, or that the only way I feel like to release it is through tears. It's natural. And sometimes, listen, I feel like I start tearing up and I'm like, stop, because y'all are like, here goes Amanda crying again. She just can't stop crying, you know? And I think that too. I'm like, oh, why, Amanda, stop being so emotional. I can't help it. I mean, to hold back one emotion, you know, of if you have an emotion, it's like trying to hold back any. You want to hold back these emotions and suppress them. You need to release them, and I guess that's the way. But going back to this video and the Leela, I mean, that's another thing. That's probably why I cry too, because I'm like, that's how I live my life. And I didn't even know the word for it. But I'm always, you know, I always say, be young at heart. Be playful. Keep that childlikeness in you. Go about life and through the eyes of a child, because that's when you're the most innocent and just the most, you know, joyous times of life. Not when the world starts stressing you out and all that. Keep that playfulness. I've always lived by this. But to now see where this path had probably, like, came from, that is probably the Krishna inside of me that's bringing this playfulness out. It just, there's just no words to describe it. The only thing to describe is the tears falling from my face. And it's not sad tears. Maybe it's happy, but it's just knowing that I have, you know, feeling that inside of me and knowing Krishna is always there, that just makes me feel that way. So I hope y'all are here. There's Amanda crying again, being ridiculous tears all the time, overreacting. No, maybe I am. This is the way I am, like it or not. All right, y'all, let me know what you think. I know I've been rambling on here. Comments, thumbs, all that. Until next time. Mwah.